David in Garland, Texas. Hello, David. Welcome.
How you doing?
Doing great. Why are you awesome. Protestant, David?
Well, I'm not a Protestant. I'm a follower of Christ. I'm a Christian.
Okay, but you're not Catholic and you're not Orthodox, right?
I'm a Christian.
Why do you object to the term Protestant?
I don't adhere to it. I'm a Christian.
Well, okay.
I'm a follower of Christ.
Okay. David, what is a Christian? Are Catholics Christians?
I believe that there are a lot of Christian Catholics.
Okay, but what makes someone a Christian?
What makes someone a Christian? Someone that puts their faith in their hope in what Christ did on the cross.
Uh-huh.
We do that.
Well, okay, but that all you have to do is you do that, and that makes you a Christian.
No, that's not all you have to do. Uh-huh. No. The reason I'm calling is there's two things. I have the Bible that I read, God's Word, it says that we have one mediator, and that's Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't see why you should have to go in a booth. I know that's how they controlled the masses in the early days of the church, is they wanted to control the masses.
Yeah, David, hold on a sec. You're just going way wide here, my friend. Let's just stick with confession to a priest. We also believe, with St. Paul, that there's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Why do we confess our sins to a priest when we can go directly to Christ, Trent Horn?
Because Jesus, Paul talks about being given the ministry of reconciliation, and this particular ministry has been given to the apostles and through to their successors who are ordained. And the scriptural support for this would be found in John chapter 20, verse 23. After Jesus' resurrection, he appears to the disciples in a locked room. He says, you know, peace be with you. And then he breathes on them and he says, if you forgive anyone's sins, they're forgiven. And if you do not forgive them, whoever's sins you forgive are forgiven. Whoever's sins you retain are retained. So the early church fathers and others understood this, that while the apostles themselves can't forgive sins, a man can't, they can do so standing on Christ's authority. That seems to make sense of the passage. It clearly says they can forgive sins. I guess my question to David would be, what does this passage in John 20:23, what else would it mean besides they can forgive people's sins?
Well, like you mentioned with the guy that you were talking to earlier, that's your interpretation of that. I don't think that that's the correct interpretation of that. Can I finish?
Go ahead.
No, actually, David, it's Patrick. Trent asked you a question, and it's a fairly good one, I think. How do you interpret it if our interpretation is wrong?
Well, I interpret it as this. If I have someone that's done me wrong, and they come to me and ask me to forgive them, and I forgive them. You know, Christ says we are to forgive everyone. We're not to hold a grudge on anyone. But again, to go back to where it says that we have one mediator, and that's Christ. We don't need the Pope. We don't need a guy behind a box to confess our sins to. We can go, Christ said, He did it all on the cross. We don't need a mediator.
Uh-huh.
The other thing I have a problem with is praying to the dead. The Bible that I read, God's Word says that we are not to communicate with the deceased.
Dave, hold on a sec. Yeah, that's called necromancy, and it's condemned by the Word of God. We agree with that. We do not commune with the dead. Catholics who do that are committing a mortal sin, actually.
That's right.
But confession. Trent, does John 22 there... simply
John 20, verses 22 through 23. Yeah.
Right. Is that just a reference to the people who offend the apostles?
No, I would say... I mean, that's one interpretation that could be made, but it's an incredibly strained interpretation. How wouldn't people at that time know if you personally forgive someone, they're forgiven in the sense that you've forgiven them? When you forgive someone personally, obviously you know that they're forgiven. But Jesus didn't say to the apostles, whose sins you forgive are no longer held against you. It just baldly says, whose sins you forgive, they are forgiven. Not that they don't have a personal grudge against you. But second, I don't think that works. Now, David, when you talk about a mediator, I agree with you that through Christ alone, our salvation has been brought, that Christ alone has atoned for the sins of the world. But just because Christ is the mediator of our redemption, it doesn't mean other people are mediators. And here's my example. Do you ask other people to pray for you?
The living, yes, not the dead.
Why do you ask... when you ask someone to pray to Jesus instead of you praying to Jesus, aren't they mediating your request to Jesus?
Christ says there's two or more that come in the midst of me, then I'll be in their presence.
No, David.
I have a problem. No,
David, hold on a sec. David, we're getting somewhere, but just I want to just trim it up a little bit.
Here's the problem. You do, when you ask someone to pray for them, to pray for you, so you think it's okay in some cases to not go to Jesus directly, to ask someone to pray for you instead.
When I ask someone to pray for me, it's not to forgive my sins. You ask Christ to forgive your sin, and Christ will go before God and be our mediator.
Right, but David, why would you ask other people to pray for you? Why not go to Jesus directly?
You do. I do.
Why do you ask your friends and relatives to do it? Why wouldn't you just go to Jesus directly?
Because God says to pray, and to pray for one another.
Sure, absolutely we should pray for one another. So David, and so we can ask other people to pray for us.
Right, but the Bible that I read says we are not to pray for the deceased. We're not supposed to pray for the saints to pray for us.
Where does it say that we're not supposed to speak to the dead?
It's there. I don't have it in front of me, but I've read it.
I believe you're referring to Deuteronomy 18, verses 10 through 11, that talk about necromancy. That particular term, yes, it does refer to two-way communication with the dead. An example of this in Scripture would be in 1 Samuel, where Saul goes to the witch of Endor and conjures up the ghost of Samuel. But I can easily show you it's not a sin to talk to the dead. So when Jesus was on earth on the Mount of Transfiguration, he spoke to Moses, right?
That was God doing that, yeah.
Right, but Moses was, but God can't do something evil.
No, God can do. He said we are not to.
Yeah, but is it? But Dave, you said you're a Christian. You believe that Jesus Christ is true God and true man, right?
He was God and man in the flesh. Yes.
So right. We can imitate what Jesus does as a man.
Again, God can do whatever he wants.
Yeah, but we're talking about God. We're talking about God the Son, David, who had a human nature and a mom and a heavenly Father. And so Trent's asking about whether or not we can imitate him in talking to people like Moses.
I mean, would you agree Jesus wasn't committing a sin when he was speaking to Moses on the Mount of Transfiguration?
No, Jesus could not sin, though.
Right. So Jesus spoke to someone who is dead, so it's not intrinsically evil. Now, I mean, David, I think the logic here, I don't see the problem with it, that we're one body. There's no division in the body of Christ, right?
Right.
Okay, and in Romans chapter 8, Paul says, nothing can separate us from the love of God. Not even death can separate us from the love of God.
Right.
Okay, so are those in heaven who are still a part of the body, are they aware of what's happening here on earth?
I'm not sure.
Do you have any reason to think that they wouldn't? Aren't they connected to us through Christ?
Where does it say in the Bible that they do?
Well, I can give you an example in the book of Hebrews. In Hebrews chapter 11, it talks about all the heroes of the Old Testament. So, you know, we have Gideon and Moses and even Rahab and others, you know, who are, you know, these heroes of the Old Testament. And then and then at the end of that chapter, it goes through all of these great people from the Old Testament. Hebrews 12:1 then summarizes everything, and it says this. So Hebrews 12:1 says, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin that clings so closely. So it's saying there that these witnesses of the Old Testament could see the audience of the letter to the Hebrews, and we have no reason to think that our ancestors in the faith can't see us right now and cheer us on in running the race.
Lots more at Catholic.com. David, I appreciate your call.